It is my pleasure to introduce Nathalie Aufauvre. And maybe I should clarify that so far, we have mainly discussed what we often call the retail CBDC or general purpose CBDC, which aims to allow the general public to have access to a digital form of central bank money, which they do not have access to at the moment. They only have access to banknotes, which is a material form of central bank money. And some central banks, in particular Banque de France, have focused on another form of CBDC, which we generally call wholesale CBDC. Indeed, to understand the logic of wholesale CBDC, we have to keep in mind that financial institutions already have access to a form of digital currency, which is the bank reserves. And the key question, and the key question which is going to be discussed by Nathalie in a minute, is whether new technologies, such as DLT, for example, could help making digital currency, central bank digital currency, which already exists in a traditional form, more efficient. And this is the other dimension that Tom Motton, for example, has mentioned also. And we know that Banque de France has chosen to focus on this form of CBDC. And that's why it's my pleasure to welcome Nathalie Aufauvre, Director General in charge of financial stability and operations at Banque de France. She will explain what conclusion could be drawn from the experiments that Banque de France has undertaken.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak about our experiments in the wholesale CBDC. As Jean-Michel mentioned, many central banks have focused their work on retail CBDCs, but we actually a fair number of central banks also work on this other form of CBDC, accessible only to financial institutions for interbank settlements, as explained by Jean-Michel. In particular, in the Banque de France decided to launch an ambitious experimentation program in March 2020 to work jointly with public and private market participants to explore the possible forms and usages of a wholesale CBDC. So I'm glad today to have the opportunity to share with you the backdrop of these experiments, their first results, which are published today, actually, and also how we intend to leverage on the first results, and of course, to further feed the global reflections on a wholesale CBDC, but also to sketch out concrete lines of progress on its possible design. Globally, tokenization of assets comes with a promise to smoothen the functioning of markets, thanks to the merits of distributed ledger technology, DLT. So it is really the heart of this idea of a wholesale CBDC. It is really related with this innovation. Their goal is to improve cost efficiency and availability around the clock and to enhance transparency with a better tracking of transactions and of asset ownership. So if we move to next slide, the question is which role for central bank money in a tokenized financial world? And when focusing on interbank financial activities, I see three major challenges for the actions of central banks. The first one, and maybe the most important one, is guaranteeing the settlement of financial transactions in systemic markets in central bank money. To this end, central banks generally offer central bank money in scriptural form for settlement purposes on traditional RTGSs. This brings stability to the whole financial system as central bank money is the safest and most liquid as settlement asset, which avoids both credit and liquidity risk. However, with the tokenization of assets circulating on DLT-based platforms, there has been a demand for putting cash on the ledger. In other words, a need for a settlement asset allowing to settle tokenized transactions directly on the ledger. This basically consists in offering a token on a DLT ecosystem and allowing transactions with this token to be settled while ensuring the delivery of assets against transfer of value, being delivery versus payment or payment versus payment in an atomic manner. The atomicity of the transfer ensures that the asset is delivered if and only its payment is performed, avoiding any counterparty risk. So let's imagine a financial world which becomes more and more tokenized. What if central banks do not make a CBDC available on DLTs? Very simple, intermediaries would increasingly turn to private settlement assets available on the ledger, i.e. crypto assets, stable coins, or tokenized commercial bank money to settle their tokenized assets. This would mean a worrying circumvention of the anchoring role of central bank money in its settlement function by the private sector. Besides potential regulation issues, this carries counterparty and liquidity risks and eventually threatens monetary sovereignty and financial stability. So it is a very important challenge for central banks. Second reason for central bank action in that space is preventing liquidity fragmentation and market disturbances. Considering the multiplicity of private initiatives on the market, there is a risk that the heterogeneous approaches of market players lead to liquidity fragmentation, because liquidity would be insulated in different pools, and therefore market disturbances. The use of the central bank money hinges to a significant extent on the provision of safe and efficient payment systems for transferring the currency. So, and furthermore, in the context of the EU single market integration, the euro system must provide harmonized services with broad participation of relevant market players. So it's also an important part of the challenges raised by DLTs and the development of this kind of liquidity pools. Preventing fragmentation that could arise from the development of private settlement assets functioning in closed loops with only limited interoperability and no direct access to central bank liquidity is the key issue. And third, third reason, is supporting innovation. Traditionally, central banks act also as catalysts of virtuous market initiatives. And in that respect, we must look thoroughly at what enhancement new technologies can bring from both a performance and safety perspective. For instance, central banks could build on tokenization to tackle major remaining inefficiencies in the world economy, and in particular in cross-border payments, which are still costly, uncertain, and incurring too long delays before settlement. So it's an important opportunity for better market, better efficiency in cross-border payments. Now, if we turn to slide three, against this backdrop, the Banque de France decided to launch an experimentation program in March 2020 to work jointly with public and private participants coming from the financial market, but also from the consulting and tech sectors, to explore the use of a wholesale CBDC. Following a call for application where we received around 40 proposals, the Banque de France selected 9 groupings and initiated as many experiments. As of today, 7 experiments have been completed, and the last 2 will be finalized by the end of this year. The intention behind this program was really to take advantage of a learning by doing approach and avoid sticking to a purely academic approach to innovation. On the contrary, our philosophy was to complement conceptual considerations with experiments in the field, gaining the necessary expertise on the best suited designs and most appropriate technological choices. More specifically, the idea was, one, to test a diversity of use cases and financial instruments, showing how wholesale CBDC can be used to settle many asset classes in various market configurations, and two, using various technologies with permissions, blockchains, public blockchains, open source, and proprietary protocols. And what we try to do is to complete these experiments in close to real-life conditions. It was not like a sandbox. And even for some experiments, by performing real trades, for example, with Société Générale Forge, with a real EIB-issued bond. And some other experiments were performed in proof-of-concept mode. In any case, we always made sure, and it was key for us, of course, that the central bank retains full control over central bank money, whatever the underlying DLT technology used, notably leveraging DLT's capability to embark programmability features. So now, if we turn to slide 4, what are the lessons learned? To enter a bit more in detail, the experiments conducted by the Banque de France have covered, as I said, various use cases, like the settlement of tokenized assets, both listed, like bonds, shares, and unlisted, like commercial paper and fund shares. A strong emphasis was put on cross-border transactions in cooperation with other central banks like SNB, the MAS, the Central Bank of Tunisia. We try to show how multi-CBDC arrangements can work in practice. And some experiments involved creating a whole ecosystem on the DLT. For instance, the Euroclear experiment involved Agence France Trésor as a French debt management office, primary OAT dealers, custodians, investors, and of course the CSD and the central bank. So really the whole ecosystem. As we are today publishing the results of our experimentation program on our website, let me underline 3 important learnings gathered from our experiments. First, a very important one, they confirm that new DLT technologies and CBDC have the potential to optimize post-trade settlements. Our experiments demonstrated notably the efficiency of CBDC as an option for cash on the ledger, for different use cases, different financial instruments, and different distributed ledger technologies. So in all cases, the usage of CBDC on the ledger was efficient. It also shows the potential of tokenization to improve settlements, first by reducing the number of intermediaries or by improving their efficiency thanks to reduced reconciliation processes and increased traceability. This could eventually shorten the trade settlement time span, reduce cost because less capital and liquidity are mobilized. And second, by increasing the availability of the payment system on a 24/7 basis, thanks to a large distribution of data and increased processing. Second lesson learned, it is the interest of CBDC as an enhancement to cross-border payments. It was really a key point for us in relationship with our involvement in the G20 roadmap for cross-border payments. Several experiments confirm the potential of CBDC to reduce existing points of friction in cross-border transactions, thanks to DLT, and facilitate interoperability between different jurisdictions. Third lesson learned, and it's very important, is the strong need for interoperability between current payment systems and DLT-based devices, and the technical feasibility to achieve this interoperability. As you know, DLT faces the challenge of maturity and of scaling up to potentially manage massive volumes of payments. Even if new systems eventually prove their capacity to do so, they will not replace legacy systems from one day to the next. Therefore, centralized and most innovative systems must coexist in a safe and efficient way in an integrated market. So it is one of the challenges that will be needed to be overcome. Another one is that we should also consider that the high number of concurrent DLT technologies makes very unlikely the rise of a unique standard. So there are consequences related with this. And the first one is that interoperability between the DLTs themselves will be required to avoid market fragmentation. So if we turn to the last slide, that being said, and the lessons learned show that there is still a long journey to reach an operational framework. And we need to explore further both business and technical questions that emerge during the experiments. On the business side, it appears useful to explore more in depth a possible use of CBDC in cross-border and cross-currency context. We really think that CBDC could dramatically reduce points of friction, and this is already a key focus of international work at G20 level. We need to continue cooperate at international level, in particular to understand how to ensure interoperability among CBDCs and how a potential new infrastructure on which multiple CBDCs could circulate could interoperate with existing infrastructures. We also deem necessary to study further how the peculiarities of different financial instruments could require specific CBDC features to fully reap the benefits from using wholesale CBDC on their respective markets. So we need to dig into more details to have all these benefits in mind. From a technical perspective, on top of already mentioned scalability and performance issues, the questions regarding security need, of course, to be thoroughly analyzed to ensure that possible DLT solutions offer a satisfactory levels of robustness, confidentiality, traceability, and resilience to cyber threats, all very important conditions. Even if some experiments highlighted the potential of DLT solutions to meet these challenges, they were not directly in the scope of our experiments, and therefore it will be critical in the perspective of development of DLTs at market scale to be really assessed. And the aforementioned questions of interoperability of DLTs with both other DLTs and legacy systems will also require a specific insight, of course, from a technical feasibility perspective, but also from a business perspective, notably as regards the governance of the proposed solutions, which is also a very important question. My personal conviction is that digitized assets and DeFi applications will have to be part of the equation. The key question is therefore not if, but how and when to perform interoperability, one, between legacy systems and new systems, and second, between different DLTs. So So these issues will have to be further explored in the near future. So in conclusion, I would formulate four strong beliefs. First, the necessity to keep central bank money as an anchor for the entire financial system, the key reason behind the experiment on wholesale CBDC. We must be ready to issue a wholesale CBDC or a CBDC in the wholesale usage if it proves necessary. Central bank money must remain the settlement asset for financial transactions. Second, it is the central bank's mission to support innovation for public welfare. The Banque de France is convinced that there is a strong potential in current new technologies, such as blockchain and tokenization, for improving both domestic and cross-border wholesale transactions. So on the question whether to launch CBDC, be it wholesale or retail, we need to decide responsibly with all parameters in hand. We need to holistically measure all the benefits but also all potential risks in operational, but also economic, monetary, and financial stability terms. And that's why, as was mentioned in the previous roundtable, we have to stick to our Hippocratic oath. First, do no harm. So that's why we really need to reflect on all these aspects. And finally, this fast evolving landscape requires more than ever a close international cooperation, as it is essential to prevent negative spillovers worldwide. I stop there, Jean-Michel.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Nathalie. Thank you for this presentation, which I understand comes exactly at the time when you are releasing your conclusions officially. And I think it should be in our bookshelf that we have mentioned at the beginning. There is one question that, like, we do not have a lot of time for questions, unfortunately, but the timing is very tight. But I would like to ask one question only for the moment, Nathalie. Perhaps we can discuss other issues afterwards in the open dialogue session. But my question here would be to say, now that you have come to these conclusions, what are the next steps? What do you intend to do? Are you going to continue experiments to select some of them? What are the next experiments that you are going to do? Or are you going to go into projects? Or what are the next steps?
We are currently assessing which use case could be further assessed or further developed, and which would merit being experimented. Because of course, on the one hand, we would like to continue experiments because they bring a lot of value, more understanding. But at the same time, we won't continue experiments forever. But we are still in the process of experiments. All this is to bring information and knowledge to the Eurosystem. Of course, the Banque de France won't enter into a project by itself. We are speaking about CBDC, but it is a digital euro which is at stake. So it should be a Eurosystem project. For the time being, the Eurosystem has decided to prioritize a retail CBDC. But of course, we need to understand more the developments in the wholesale CBDC. That's why we are at a very preliminary phase with experiments, because we think it's the only way to understand really the added value of a wholesale CBDC. So we are still in this phase. We envisage to pursue our work with further experiments, especially on interoperability and cross-border payments, which seem to us key in assessing the potential of these new technologies. So that's for the time being, further experiment. Of course, we will communicate on it in due course, so stay tuned. And that's all for the moment. We really work for the whole Eurosystem and will provide the outcome of our work to the whole Eurosystem.
Okay, thank you very, very much, Nathalie. And again, if you have a few moments, you can join us in the open dialogue session, which will open in a few minutes from now. I'd like to thank you again, Nathalie, and also all our speakers for today's session.